I've traveled pretty extensively in the pines over the last 30 years. I've covered the pines from Monmouth County, Middlesex County, all the way down to Cape May systematically. I've put on close to 300,000 miles just covering the pines. And I think Beck, more than any of the other historians, covered the area. He covered it very well. He got around to it. He was a historian, but not in the same sense. He was more of a writer than a historian. But his books are full of history if you know what to do with the information. The problem is a lot of people can't take a little clue and take it from there. It's not a history book, but there's a lot of historical information that's a gold mine if you know how to interpret it. I've had many clues from Beck that panned out eventually. They may not have made sense at the moment, but somewhere down the line, when I got other information, they came together. I found many places because of Beck. But he had been there, I assure you that, and that's many other historians can't say that. Well, I know pretty well what was there, in the interim period, because I had been in the house several times. What was there at the time of the burning of the house was really not worth salvaging. And things had been picked over pretty well at that stage and was pretty beat up. I think anything that just stuff was just strewn around, It stomped on and soaked and tarnished to the point that it was fairly useless. There were some botanical journals, Philadelphia Torium bulletins and things of that nature, and some glass fragments and things like that that certainly not things that were of any particular value, not at that stage. I think that the problem was with Rodney's declining health, and he couldn't very well keep an eye on a place. It's a shame. Fortunately, I got good photos of the house over the years, but it's a shame that the
You
place.
have good photos?
Oh, yeah. I got.
Black and white?
No, I take everything color. Gosh, my Pine Barrens collection's over 10,000. Fifty percent of things that are no longer in existence today, so you know.
Plants and houses?
Buildings, yeah. Oh, plants, I got just about all the plants too, yeah. Through one of the most frequent reasons cited for the decline of the industry was the introduction of anthracite coal in the hematite mining areas of Pennsylvania and northern New Jersey. However, I think one of the key reasons that is so overlooked is the decline of the bog ore in the South Jersey pines. There was also a decline of the or diminishing of the lumber supply here that provided the charcoal so necessary to smelting the ore. So somewhere between these three reasons lies the cause of the decline of the iron industry in southern New Jersey.
Well, you of course need sand. You need soda, potash, and some kind of lime base to stabilize the batch. And you need skillful mixers who have formulas that know just what percentage to use of each of these products. And these were top kept secrets from one glass work to another. those who had excellent mixers and knowledge of how to mix this material probably did better than those who had less skillful people involved. Once the batch was mixed, it would go into a calcar furnace, which was a sort of a preliminary type of furnace where the batch was heated and burned off a number of the impurities. It was constantly mixed in there. And then it would go into the main furnace to develop a vitrified goo or mass. And this eventually would be worked by the glass blowers. They would get a batch of it out of the glory hole, which was the main opening of the furnace. And of course, the molten glass would be in large containers or pots that were made of clay in the early days, or at least clay lined. These were vats that would hold considerable batch. And from that main batch, individual globs or blooms were removed and either blown by means of blowpipes or put into from blowpipes converted into the cylinders for window glass, put into the cylinders, blown into there, and then eventually worked into sheet glass, which was put in cooling furnaces or lower heat furnaces where they could be unfurled and pressed out, which were window lights, as they called them, were one of the major products of some of those furnaces. It was nothing like the pure glass you make today. Down at Batstow, you'll still see windows made the old cylinder way, the wavy refraction. The light comes through and it's rather refracted because it isn't perfectly clear as glass is today. Unfortunately, some of these railroads didn't affect certain factories, that is, positively affect them. They take Herman, for example. It was only near the water route, the Mullica River, but there was no railroad in the area to assist it in removing its products to market. And I think that, to some degree, jeopardized the position. Towns along the railroad, Atco Glass Works, for example, was along the railroad and was very successful. And Lebanon, another one that was not along the railroad, didn't last very long, 4 or 5 years at the most, at least when it hit its zenith. But I think rail lines had a direct effect on them, and certainly enhanced their ability to make money, because they could quickly get their products to market and bring in the raw materials as well. Well, in South Jersey, in New Jersey in general, in the early iron-making days, the major fuel was charcoal. The wood supply was readily available. In the pines, pine and oak was burned into charcoal equally. Other woods can be used to make charcoal as well. But down here, pine and oak were the primary charcoal fuels. It was in abundant supply, and it was a hot fuel. Charcoal is a very hot fuel. Most of the American furnaces never wanted to deal with coke like the British furnaces did, the English. Traditionally, these were charcoal people over here. It's hard to buck tradition locally. The glass houses burned primarily wood, and yet were able to generate degrees of, you need 2700 degree temperature, and they were able to generate this with wood, which is quite amazing. So 2700 degrees and up, you know, your oven's about 500, so just think of the temperature you're creating here. And they would frequently cut this wood into short pieces. They need an awful lot of woodcutters and for all of these operations. Iron, glass, in particular. And in the case of glass houses, much of that wood was reheated in ovens to cure it, to speed on the process of making it the most hot or potentially hot fuel they could make it without creating charcoal. Evidently, they didn't need the charcoal. They didn't quite need the heat that you need in iron production. But they needed pretty hot fires, and they preheated this material. And you needed all kinds of workers. You needed wood choppers. You needed gatherers. You needed people to stoke these ovens. And in charcoal making, you needed an equal number of people. Chopping again, sorters. The coal had to be taken, hauled. So you had haulers that hauled it to furnace sites. It had to be housed in buildings to keep it dry. And you had quite a number of people employed just for cutting wood into proper length and stacking it and burning it. As I said, there's ore still to be found, but certainly nothing like those vast supplies that once existed there. And I think anyone that tries to say there's an abundance of ore out there today, as it was at one time, does not know the complete story. Now, the wood cycle, certainly, if you cut down a pine tree and an oak out here, particularly a chestnut oak, which is quite frequent in the pines, or scrub oak, or barrel, blackjack oak, they're heavy sprouting oaks, and they'll come back. And everything you see today that's timber size has regenerated within the last 20 to 30 years. Lebanon forest is a classic example of what happens to forest that is cut down for the purpose of firewood for your fireplaces. They allow people on permits to come in and timber off a certain area. Within 15, 20 years, the trees come back. Go down into the plains and you'll see what fire has done. A fire will scorch that area, and within 6 months you'll see vegetation coming back rather profusely. If you head down the shore on Route 72 beyond Lebanon Forest, just beyond the railroad bridge, on the right you'll see an area that burned in 1977. Was totally timbered off at that time. And here we are, 1987, and you see a pretty good indication of how fast these forests regenerate. So I think that aspect of the iron industry was calculated fairly accurately. But as far as the ore was concerned, they're still hoping for it to come back. Well, the yellow or amber glass, they put in, what is it they put in there? Sulfur, I believe, goes in there, yeah. Sulfur. To clear up the glass, they put in manganese oxide. It gives you a clearing. They put in the sulfur that causes a discoloration or a yellowing of glass. And I suppose over time it may turn green. I'm not too certain about what eventually brings out that color. Sometimes, you're familiar with the glass insulators that you see on telephone poles. That glass discolors with time, and a lot of it does the same thing. In time, there's a coloration it takes on, and it goes from pure crystal color to a yellowing or greening. And this may be a part of an aging process, in addition to what goes into the glass. The primary reason for the decline of the iron industry in South Jersey was twofold. The depletion of ore, of an ore supply, which I think has not been stressed enough. texts about the iron industry, and also certainly there was a lessening of the wood supply, but I don't think the Pennsylvania furnaces actually replaced the ones here locally. I think if the ore supply had continued, we would have found a way to get fuel in here to continue that. But I think if you look at the records of the individual furnaces, what few records we do have, there's an ever-increasing mention of importation of ore from mountain areas, mountain ore, which strongly suggests the depletion of the local ore supply. So I think that is one of the major reasons the iron industry faded out rather quickly after the 1840s in South Jersey. I think it would have lingered another 20, 25 years successfully if that hadn't occurred here. You know, regardless of the anthracite furnaces, which of course was a ready fuel supplier for Pennsylvania, I think they would have continued to coexist, these furnaces.